what will happen in quarter four in FY19 as well, is that elusive earnings recovery finally underway? Who better than Aditya Narain, the head of research at Edelweiss Securities, to talk about this and more? Aditya, thanks so much for speaking to us
at
Bloomberg. Really good having you. What did you make of Q3?
Well, in many senses, at the aggregate, they came in more or less in line with expectations. So I think to some extent, that's a relief because so far you've been tending to miss right through, right? So I think that in some senses is a relief and a form of comfort. The second bit is, I think, you're beginning to see, right, volume expansion and domestic consumption starting to show much, much more transaction. And that is, I think, very, very important because it gives you a sense of the general health of the economy. I think on the investment side, you're still tending to see patchy numbers, but what you're beginning to see is the construction companies beginning to show much nicer order books. So I think that again tells you that at a recovery level, you are now seeing solid signs of an incipient recovery. It's not a full-blown recovery, but the signs that you're getting an incipient recovery, both on the, well, clearly on the consumption side, but a little bit on the investment side, I think that gives you a fair amount of comfort. That said, I think the big swings really have been earnings on the commodity side, which has really been the overall support for the earnings system. And there have been surprises on the banking side, which has brought down the overall averages. So that, in any case, is a little bit of a swing factor, is driven more by pricing and provisioning and in this quarter with interest rates. So that's a balancing factor. But if you take that out, the rest of it does show a certain amount of health from a consumption perspective, from an incipient investment side, which I think is positive.
Okay. And I'll talk about each of these as well. Yeah. But first, the headline numbers, Aditya. Based on what we've done so far, I remember Q1 was a big disappointment. Q2, I think we reverted to mean. Q3, yeah, as you said, we've probably delivered what we expected. Where are we in the number estimates that you had for FY18? And what are you penciling in for FY19 in your broad estimates? Are you penciling in the earnings recovery, the incipient economy facing recovery that you just spoke about, or is that out of the equation for FY19 at least?
Well, to some extent, we do start factoring in that incipient recovery. See, what has historically happened with Indian numbers is they've started at 20% at the beginning of the year and they've all worn down, right? Now, this year it is looking a little better.
It is?
It is looking a little better because the first was weak, second was on par, third is on par, but above expectation, above, you know, the 0% level, right? And I think this trend should by and large continue. The swings again will be at the absolute level. You will have these swings from the banking side because you don't know when provisioning will get capped out, whether it's going to be this quarter or it could stretch a little bit more. Likewise, on the commodities, it is a little hard to make that call on whether this kind of momentum will effectively continue. So that's why, as I said in my preface, I think the fact that the consumption side, that you're beginning to see volumes and you can argue some levels on the investment side, I would tend to believe the numbers have not really changed for us at the aggregate for what we are looking at FY19. And, you know, surprisingly, or not so surprisingly, it is looking like a 20% number. But I think it is something that you can increasingly aspire for, because now you're getting pockets of growth which you didn't have. And those are based, as I said, not so much on price, but on volume, which is where the comfort tends to be.
Okay. So what are your numbers like for FY18? Are you anywhere, you would be anywhere between 450 to 500 for the Nifty?
We're at about 490.
490.
Yeah.
You think there's a fair chance that we'll hit that number?
I think we should. Okay. I mean, again, there is a variation as far as the banks are concerned, particularly how interest rates are playing. And, you know, you could well have a situation where rates come off and you have a certain amount of write back of all the pain that's been taken in this quarter. But that remains a little bit of a variable. But the numbers as we have post the quarter are 490 for this year and about 600 for FY19.
Yeah, with the 20% assumption, I thought 600 would be a...
Yeah, that's where you're basically looking.
So let's assume that's your base case scenario.
Yeah.
It is, right? If that is your base case scenario, would you be comfortable with the kind of valuations that we'll be trading at 600 for FY19? You would presume that we are not really in the terribly expensive zone. We are probably in the fair valuation zone.
I think so. And I think there are two parts to it. I think where are we in the valuation zone, firstly. Secondly, where are we in the recovery stage, and which determines valuations in many senses, because, you know, you can really argue for a much stronger growth effectively beyond that, right? And I think third is, where are we on the overall economic cycle? You must remember that we've had 3, 4, 5 years now of restructuring that has actually gone on. When you get through that, you will inevitably, if external elements don't conspire against you, you can effectively get 3, 4, 5 years of decent and long growth. And I think we are very well positioned on that front.
Okay.
So given that you're where you are, I would argue that the market can basically trade at a higher levels rather than necessarily always be pegged to its mean. Right. When do you, the mean is formed of when you're trading at higher levels and the average is when you're trading at lower levels. Right. And I think this is a point in time where you will tend to trade at your higher levels because you should have economic tailwind that can sustain for a bit. See, it's the stage of recovery also, right? And if we've got it right, then these are early stages of recovery, which will give you an extended run over a couple of years.
Yeah, but we don't always work in isolation, right? I mean, as much as we would want the global factors to not give us an unpleasant shock, we have to recognize that we are probably in an era wherein there's an outside chance, I'm not saying it's a certainty, I mean, probably nobody knows, there's an outside chance that the hikes in the US may be quicker and more than what anybody anticipates as well. What happens if that plays out and a couple of other factors plays out as well in terms of flows?
See, I think you have to look at two elements to it, right?
Sure.
One is the market element or the macro element. The other is the economic element, okay, which is the growth element and what's happening to the underlying economy. If you were to look at the growth element or the economic element, we are actually lagging the broader world. Our economic recovery has been slower and lower, right, than what you're seeing across the world. So in some senses that you have the cushion that even if you were to align the cycle, right, India actually has a certain amount of catch up to do, right? So I think that is very primary. Let's not always get caught up with the market element or the macro element or the level of rates element, right? But as far as the economy is concerned, economic growth and economic recovery is concerned, we are lagging, we have a certain amount of catch up to do, and therefore we have a certain amount of cushion. So that's one part. And I think this is going to be the story over FY, or over the current year, and I think potentially beyond, that the economy at the underlying will start doing better and it has a certain amount of catching up to do. So it could be a more extended economic cycle than globally. Your point on bond yields and on macro, I think is very well taken. Right, that you could have a certain amount of uncertainty there, you are having a certain amount of uncertainty there. And that can keep both valuations in a flux and can hurt flows, right? So I think that remains the thing that you need to worry a little bit about or watch for a little bit more closely. The issue with that is it is very hard to call that. So the way I would look at it is that this element will create more volatility in the market, whether it is event based, whether it is rate hike based, or whether it is just general flows and things that can disrupt markets. The way I would look at it is that is what is potentially going to give you opportunities to buy and to trim, right? You have events of rates going up, markets come off, it gives you a little bit of a price point which can actually get you to buy, right? But I think that is going to make it a more uncomfortable year than what you've had in the last 1 or 2 years.
Sure.
So that'll be, even though the economic side or the corporate earnings side is actually going to be much better and much more stable.
Yeah.
Right. And I think, I mean, it's going to be in contrast to what you saw last year, right? Where it was all macro, right?
Yeah.
Without enough micro and you still got a lot of returns, right? What it meant was that you had very limited volatility. This year, you'll probably get much more micro, but it'll be less comfortable on the macro, which in my view, and that's a call you have to make, that is going to be an extended cycle, will give you opportunities.
Okay, so in your view, it will give you opportunities. Okay,
yeah.
Let's talk about the couple of negatives first before we move on to what could work and what has worked in quarter three as well.
Right.
Actually, can I first start off with that? What's worked in quarter three?
Absolutely.
Because you would argue that rural consumption has done well, maybe IT has done well, but a lot of other pockets, PSU banks, for example, just kind of put paid to any kind of earnings beat that could have come in quarter.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I think, as I said, the most robust part of this is really the consumption side, which is more broad based, where the volumes are coming back, you know, notwithstanding the fact that there was a base effect, even on a Q on Q basis, you have actually seen volumes come back. I think that was probably the healthiest part of this entire quarter. And I think that's a very hopeful part of it because, you know, when you start seeing volumes, right, I think that gives you a sense that there is activity going on, there is a buzz going on. And that, I think, is the most, that tells you that there's a certain vibrancy in the economy,
sure,
right? that is what then leads to smaller amounts of investments, smaller amounts of expansion, and at an aggregated level, it also provides you a certain amount of big picture investment. And I think that would be the biggest positive. I think the PSU banks and the banks in general have tended to be a little bit of a disappointment, you know, these recent revelations notwithstanding, right? I think the challenge has been twofold, that you've been expecting asset recoveries or asset resolutions or asset pricing in terms of provisioning, and that has got pushed back. And has got combined with a period when yields have gone up, right, which makes it harder for P&Ls to support some of these charges that come through. So I think that is really the pushback that has been there in the quarter, that at a big macro level, does the risk that the micro cannot translate into macro investments because this intermediate layer in between has a little bit of a challenge.
Okay.
And I'd say that is where it becomes a little bit of a sticking point in terms of how you pronounce the recovery as it goes out and how you pronounce the mood of the market.
Okay, what do you think of autos? The numbers, save for maybe Tata Motors, looked ho-hum, the commentary was pretty okay, but the valuations have taken a bit of a beating, or at least the stock prices have taken a bit of a beating in the recent past.
Yeah, I think in some senses, again, the demand side looks good. Management, very few management want to be very bullish, right?
Right.
But if you look at the overall numbers across two-wheelers, across trucks, across four-wheelers, I think by and large there is a robustness in it. I think from a market and a valuation perspective, it was basically at for a point in time, it was the only game in town. Now there are other games in town, so I think there's a little bit of correction in that. The market had generally moved globally. There's been a little bit of a challenge. So I'd say the explanation for the market pullback on numbers is predominantly a market element and the fact that these stocks had moved, rather than anything that's come out in the numbers or in the commentary, which I think continues to be really reasonably consistent.
Okay, so what's the other game in town that is looking as strong? You mentioned in addition to autos, there's probably other things which are started looking really well.
I think in terms of numbers, if you were to see, if you were to look at commentary, I think the consumer credit side still continues to be very decent.
Mm-hmm.
I'd say the construction side, I think that looks very healthy. They're much smaller businesses, but I think that is a very encouraging place where you've actually had a certain amount of consolidation in the number of companies and the way they're getting orders.
Yeah, long spoken about, but hasn't quite meaningfully come through. You thought it came through in quarter three?
I think clearly. See, what you don't want and what the market will not pay for is, you know, you just show huge order books and people are not sure of the money you're making or the margin that's behind it. In fact, if anything, what you did see was a reasonable build-up in order books, not as much as the biggest bulls would have expected, but almost everyone showing a margin expansion. And I think that is very material, because what it is showing is that the quality of order booking for the guys who are taking them is actually very good.
Okay.
And I think that is very, very important, right? Mm-hmm. I'd say, I think the metal side was, of course, clearly quite robust, but that is something that can't be attributed to local factors. I'd say IT was a little bit encouraging, right?
The numbers. Large cap too? I mean, mid cap, yes.
Mid cap has already done well, but I think large cap too, the commentary that you're getting and the fact that the US seems to be chugging along so well at this point in time, and the fact that in your books you've got a decent amount of digital growth, I think that combination is actually playing through reasonably well.
Do you guys like large cap IT out here? I mean, the top four or five?
Well, selectively, but we do believe that as a macro theme, that is something that is clearly coming back. Mm. I think the way their portfolios are put together, because for a long time, you had the challenge that digital was a very small part of your business, right? And that was what was showing traction. Now that has become a much larger part, or a part that makes a difference if you grow rapidly. I think some of the area, the adjustments to cloud and stuff like that, the bulk of that has tended to happen. So I think there you're tending to see a change, but selectively we like stocks there.
Okay, large cap, mid cap, both? Or do you believe mid cap has done its bit already?
Well, I think mid caps have had a good enough run. I think there'll probably be a little bit more risk adjusted opportunity on the large cap side.
Okay, risk adjusted opportunity on the large cap side. Great. Healthcare, not enough index presence compared to what used to be the case. But is it possible to talk about green shoots here, or does it remain too volatile to be able to call it right now?
I think at a sectoral level, it remains a little early, right? Okay. The US continues to see, at least in the regular generic space, more than pricing competition, a huge amount of filing that's happening. You know, I think what's changed is the number of people providing it. So it just naturally flows through more competition, right? Complex generics is a little different. I think that people will have much better pricing, but that'll tend to be more selective and slower in coming through. I think the domestic has been a little softer than what people would have expected, whether it is the GST or the demon or the whole balancing on that front. But yeah, there isn't enough to suggest that you're going to get a material delta on that part. And again, you can argue that the adjustments are taking place, but are you close to the end of the adjustment cycle is a little hard to call. It'd probably be a little presumptive to call that.
Yeah, it's interesting. When Taro came out, or for Sun Pharma numbers too, the talking point was halal inspection and not really what will happen to the numbers.
Absolutely. Right. So at the moment, and I think finally, you know, this has two elements. The regulatory bit has been very uncertain. Quite honestly, I think it'll get more predictable, at least in terms of timelines, rather than the decisions that you get. I think one thing that the FDA has done, at least our sense, is that they're speeding up, right, and giving you timelines in terms of when their decisions will come. So that will bring in a certain amount of predictability in terms of when stuff will come. What will come, of course, remains unpredictable. But I would tend to believe the diversion of the market's focus, right, from the real business will moderate a little bit going forward as far as pharma is concerned. So they will start looking much more at the real business. But the real business is not at a stage yet where you can say, okay, at most it's another quarter, so I'm ready to take the chance now.
Okay. Interesting. Last couple of pockets, and I wanted your view on cement. Now, a clutch of people bullish on this as an ancillary to the whole growth theme that we'll have. I thought, save for maybe ACC and maybe a couple of others, the numbers didn't quite live up to the mark. Or do you think?
Well, you know, as far as our numbers are concerned, they actually did much better.
Oh, yeah? So they
did much better. Obviously, you know, cement is one of those, everyone has a view on it, and, you know, it's obviously an important part of what the rest of the economy is tending to do. Our sense was that while you haven't got the pricing and you haven't got the volume that you would have expected, I think the tightening in terms of how businesses have been operating has been actually much more significant than people have realized. And that's why you're getting aggregate numbers that I think are a little better than what the market expected. At least clearly compared to what we expected, it was a pretty strong quarter.
What, operationally in bottom line, not on the top line?
Not on the top line. That's what I'm saying. Not necessarily in terms of volume, not in terms of price, but the bottom line that is coming through just better management of costs and logistics and transportation and stuff like that, the numbers have tended to be a little better there.
So you think the earnings growth could actually come in a meaningful way for cement in FY19 because volumes or price or both could make a comeback?
Yes, they could. And obviously, the operating leverage is very high in a business like this. I would say the numbers would be good, but I don't think the underlying, either in terms of price or volume, will be runaways. You know, I think it is more of I think there is this market expectation that you will get a V at some point in time, whether it is a capex spend and so ancillaries that feed into it. I think it will tend to be a more measured kind of U. But because they've created a base where their operating costs have been tightened up very substantially, I think the bottom line impact could tend to be a little higher as long as some of those numbers come through.
Okay, quick 30 seconds, Aditya. We are out of time, but one dark horse, earnings-wise for calendar year 18 or FY19?
Well, IT is not particularly sensitive. I think the banks you could actually. Banks is a function of how they provide, right? If they are tough and tight in the last quarter, if you notice what's come out in the press in terms of some of the expected recoveries that you are talking about in these asset sales, that could give you a little bit of cushion. So that could be a pretty nice one.
Wow. Okay. Let's wait and watch. Hopefully, all of this measures up to a fantastic Q4 and an even better FY19. Certainly, the bulls are hoping for that.